economic itself, except for the police, it was very economical, my lord. Then you introduce the notion of stability for the spheres, which I don't get into detail, but it eliminates the one of stability for vector bundles on the curve. And then there's a normal space to this, which I, for a while, is that the nonlinear by M, to differentiate from another normal space, the nonlinear by M global, and it's attached to C, the normal curve. The bundle has a degree, so I take this pair, the bundle is rank n, and the bundle has the degree, then it is the degree. And then this is the positive vector graph. Now, I'm always going to take these two numbers to equal prime. This is actually a smooth positive vector graph. And then essentially because your bundle is the bundle morphism is between P and itself twisted by omega 1, and you also want more in the definition to see that you can do this as a section of some total bundle. And then N lives inside of here. Actually, the whole potential bundle of N is inside of it. Then we do some local calculation to complete the dimension. Depending. We do some calculation, and then you see that this has dimension twice this. So you see that this inside of here is closed, and this inside of here is open and dense. However, it's not everything. And there's a complement that, frankly, I still don't understand. This space, now I'm going to try to explain that when you have a beta or bundle with an endomorphism like this, this rise, each one of these gives rise to an auxiliary object called the spectral curve. And this is a curve that moves inside the surface, and the surface is the total space of the canonical bundle on the curve. The basic idea is that if you're on the original curve C, and then you pick a point here, then you have the bundle, and then it's realized, and then you would write this as a map. From the bundle to itself, and then you take the eigenvalues. Because trivialized, you just think about the eigenvalues as scalars, but when you think about this in absolute terms, then they're vectors in the potential bundle. So every point in here gives you an eigenvalue. These are vectors inside of a line, and the line is dependent line. And then when you take the focal space, you put all these things together, and then you get a curve. And that's called the spectral curve. system on the surface and they give rise to curves that arise with this construction, they form an affine linear space. So there's an affine space form of direction.
Very intensively starting in the 70s.
by historical sculpture, it's constructed using the methods of geometric invariant theory with Mount Hill. And now I have this new variety, or in a set of this variety. So people like Newstead using topological method computed for SL2 or for GL2 if you want, the head number of this option. Hardware and our Siemens, or was hardware, I don't remember the name, but anyway, using the data projections, they computed the syntax numbers by counting the number of points, counting the number of numbers. And so this is the end of the story of connections, yes, by counting points and counting the numbers. And this was okay. But then, this was put in the term of association theory by Ian Ball. So, association theory is not very important, it's not the same. And then, Nietzsche introduced the space among the space of his hardware and Ball. And realized that actually we can study two different directions. All of these, and two others that we just mentioned, for example, they are hyperfields. One significant development in the study of the spaces is that Rho studied the fibers of this map, some of the fibers. Not the smooth ones, but the ones that, which are the first time that we can see that the least worst in the lab is the connection. And we put this fundamental lemma. And it's not being a much good. So this is about the compact element code, and for me there is this curve C, so my curve. And you can use that object to model this space of particles. But then, I'll oversimplify. Then you take the representations of the fundamental group of the curve into the reductive group, so for example, the reduction. Then you take the modelizing opposite. And you call this space M effective. There's a new complex function here for F. And then there's another space, but I don't want to spend time describing it. It's the space, if you have these representations, you can integrate them and throw the new right. Sorry, you can start with bundles about them. So you can see the bundles of the connection. That would give rise to a third space called the Rang space, but today I need to consider this and this. So the third person, third individual here. But today I can what is the girl with the mask? It's called Lamia Mashkir, because when you take GL1, these complex aspects, in fact, are essentially chloride, obtained by the bed homology by simple analysis. And so you just find that the whole homology, the bed homology, and the drug homology. This needs some 1 week, and the level is called Lamia Mashkir. So these are different models. Not by all markets. And the figure of the not as a market is that very correct. So, as the VAs are interested on this side of the story, and they actually have several conjectures proved in some item trigger cases concerning happy number. Actually, more precisely, these are algebraic varieties. You see that they're the one that carries a mixed color structure. So, there's a mixed structure. We go into homology. Inside of homology, they do find a natural filtration of the homology according to certain structure. This filtration is called the weight filtration. So this weight filtration exists a priori in any complex algebraic variety, and Alvin Villegas proved in the case of GL2 how this structure is supposed to look like. In other words, they have three formulas. Thank you. like this meditation. I hope this does not end. But it's easier for me to do it. So, every lecture is something and proven. Yeah, too. It's something along this line. I also remember the weight of equation so that it makes sense to right minds. Since there is this difficulty, it makes sense to transfer anything from here to there. Like if you take from one to here. So you can take the subspaces here and put them there. They will transfer it. Now, these are both algebraic varieties, and so they both have homology with their own wave of frustration. So this set is from the frustration. So you can ask whether it's different size, but they don't, because this is pure and this is not pure. So these two are not the same. So the question is, after you transfer it over there, does it mean something over there? We name this part of the whole. And if you're lucky, theoretical part of it. Yeah. transfer the infiltration from the bed space to the inward oxygen, it becomes the reverse air filtration for the ancient ones.
So that's how you state the first conjecture that occupies me from time to time. So see my curve. You can state it for any complicated manifold, but I don't know anything about longitudinal curves. Then you can form the row space of fixed aridatic group. Then you have an angle ball of C and bed of C. And anyway, so this is just a topological gadget because it only depends on the fundamental group. So this is independent of the complex structures. On C. There's a diffeomorphism, there's Simpson's theory. So conjecture. Looking myself out of the very mean. That the intermediate location. For example, the GLA. See the GLA too, but we don't know whether it should be GLA too.
What's the difference? What's the difference?
That the wave filtration transferred from the reverse space homology is the perverse filtration. And so I abbreviate that as Q. So the curious Avalanche's theorem is explained by the relative Avalanche's theorem. The curious Avalanche's conjecture should be explained by this conjecture. So, this is the state of the GLA. And in our picture, so I am emitting a family of curves. smooth the projection. So at least S and S above it, I have a curve CS. And for this curve CS, I have my normal space, and I have my vector space. Remember, this is depends only on the fundamental group, so this is independent of the complex structure. Instead, this depends. Wow. Now, this gives rise to vibration. Where at point in the base, I insert my two moduli spaces, and because they are defined through moduli, if I have a family of curves over S, this defines automatically a family of moduli spaces varying over S. And in this case, because of this independence, this is just m by 2 times S. Now, the advantage of the both sides is that I can insert in the middle the target of the region, which is a fine space cross S. So the cohomology, if I take a direct image of the constant shift here, you do my name this maps, U and V. Get a constant, a locally constant shift, which in fact is constant because that's a part. Now, let's do a diffeomorphic over S by the non-Abelian Hodge theorem. And so, even if this depends on the complex structure, when I push the forward to V, I get the same thing. Now, these two are identified, and these are subspaces. So, one way to formulate the P equal W conjecture is that WS, which is constant, should be PHS. In other words, PHS should be independent of the complex structure. So, P equals W is equivalent to PHS independent of S. Independent of S. In particular, figure is not so familiar, sorry. So we prove this, giving evidence for this. Now I want to give a little bit, very rough idea about what's going on. So let me rewrite this picture here. I drop some images. This is my totality of my total spaces for every curve over S. And this is just a copy of A repeated for every S. So this is morphism here. So, if I take 2 points here, I want to compare the homology at S to the homology at T. Now, keep in mind that I already know the homology is isomorphic, because the Lobov space is the vector space, and the vector space is independent of S. So these are isomorphic, but I want to say this in a complicated way. So I want to consider this so I can always fix it. I fix this point, for example, and I consider this point as varying. Then I take a little disk, S, that passes to T. And so now I restrict over that disk, and so now I have a morphism from M to a disk. So now I can think that this is a disk. So I'm studying a fabrication over a disk, and this is where usually you end up with your end-to-end combat with the Bayesian cycle. Okay, so there's here the Bayesian cycle, and anti cycle. Now here, at least from the point of view of what's going on here, everything seems to be quite easy, because if I consider this, then you are right. You always think by using notation, and in my head, this is kind of standard notation. I don't have time to look at that. Then there is a triangle, you know, it has something new, you are only like sequence of factors. And I use notation where I don't have to worry about translating and stuff like that. So this is like what happens in the right category, like this distinguished triangles so with the homology and turn into long exact sequences of homology. Now, because this is essentially a vibration, so this complicated thing over S is different morphic to this, so it's essentially a product. The theory of the vanishing cycle says that if I plug this into this picture, this is going to be zero. So it's like a fiber bundle. This map says what happens on one fiber, and this captures what happens at the generic fiber. It's a bundle, nothing happens. That means this goes away. So this says this. Then in the homology, you find this. So this was the complicated way to say this. Okay. Now I need this because I want to study the perverse filtration. So I need to insert that technology set up here to extract that. And I want to explain that very quickly. Not in deep, of course, but it gives an idea about what you could do, which is not difficult, except for one aspect that has to be dealt with. So, so, okay. discussion before just with this isomorphism. This is Morley, the cohomology of the central fiber, and this is Morley, the cohomology of the midline fiber. And so that's what I have here, over there. And now I want to throw into the game this game of taking perverse cohomology sheets.
Using Alexander's
Oh, okay, so that's a good question. I don't know if I'm using that. I'm using a compactification that comes from Simpson. Schmidt constructed a compactification, which is not work, so I don't know if they're doing something. Probably. And then there's a third one, going to Housel, and they're probably all the same, but it's not in the literature as far as I know. You have to do something. But I don't know. But the point is that I need the one from Simpson because I need to control the boundary. And with the one by Housel and by Schmidt, I personally don't know how to control the boundary. So there's a method into Simpson to construct this that takes time. And what happens is that the boundary can be, to some extent, controlled so that you can plug it into this reason. And let me just say two words about that. The idea is that you take your M and your S, and then you take your let me say that it's a direction. I take essentially M, just one copy, find C, so over C I have a position like this, and then I take the origin, and over the origin I take M, but I remove the fiber of the leaching mat over the origin of A. Oh, so I remove the central fiber of the leaching part, not the central fiber of this projection, obviously. So there is a fiber here, but there's a puncture, I'm turning away something. All the other fibers are the same. So imagine something like this, and then I remove something, and then all the others are the same. And then I construct an obvious six direction here, compatible with the trivial standard six direction here, and then you combine. The point is that this is all smooth, and this divisor at zero, which becomes the divisor at infinity in this construction, is smooth. So I have a construction in this space with a divisor in this GM complex, and then I divide by GM, and then this is to be viewed in this complex. So I take the stack associated with this. Why? Not because I understand it better, in fact I understand it worse, but I can use a theorem. So that's why people learn about stacks. Because then they can use theorems. So at this point, I use the theorem, but I don't know what's going on. The theorem is that because this is smooth and this is smooth, it's coarse among my space, which is my quotient. Which is also not before. And then the theorem by Van der Bear, very nice theorem, is that even if I have no idea what's going on with the stabilizers, because the boundary divisor comes from a smooth divisor with a C-star quotient, this can be resolved. Such a way that this is smooth
and this is a natural, it's a
simple normal crossing natural. Now, to people with experience in these kind of compactifications and resolutions, at least to me, this is nothing less than a miracle. Because as you change the complex structure of the curve, the C direction is always a nice C direction, but the stabilizer is there. From point S to point T, the orders of the stabilizer may vary. And when this order varies at a special point, you would expect this to jump. Instead, according to the theorem, I'm going to vary.
this is what I'm trying to correct is the technical and discussing is involved. Once you have the smoothness for each individual component that don't manifest, then you can push through that simple minded argument in the contract case.